today's Pet Pawcast. I'm your host, Dr. Roberta Westbrook, and we are here at the campus for all animals, the Houston SPCA. So again, it's still the beginning of the new year. Happy New Year. I hope everything's going well and you are keeping those New Year resolutions, especially the ones we talked about last week about you and your pet staying very healthy. In the meantime, please consider coming on down to our campus and looking at all of the pets we have available for adoption. We have dogs and cats and puppies and kittens and rabbits and guinea pigs and ferrets and birds. So please make a day of it. Bring your family and friends and come on down and visit us every day from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. And you have to come and meet Galant. Galant is our pet of the week this week. He is an adorable, friendly dog. You know, the thing I love about Galant is he has somewhat of an intimidating look, like a big, tough dog, but he's really just a teddy bear, a true teddy bear. He's about a four-year-old, maybe Rottweiler mix, but he's a little more fluffy than a Rottweiler, and his color is a little bit different, but I love that tough look that gives you that intimidating look, but he's really just a big old bear. Look at him. He's so sweet. He would make a wonderful family pet. He's good on a leash. He loves to play. He knows how to sit. He loves other animals. So I think you've got to come spend some time with Galant. Wonderful, wonderful pet. And we have lots of dogs just like Galant looking for their forever home. So when you get a chance, please come on down this weekend and visit us here at the Adoption Center and see if you can find a pet that can be part of your family forever. Okay, so today we are going to talk a little bit about budgeting for your pet. Again, it's the new year. We discussed last week about things that we're going to do to be better prepared for our pets in the new year and set new goals. One of those goals I mentioned is just being prepared financially, especially if you have not adopted a new pet and you're thinking about it. This is the perfect time to plan financially. A lot of the reason that we get pets surrendered to us, owned pets surrendered to us, is because they have medical conditions or, you know, illnesses or injuries that maybe their families were not prepared for financially. And because of that, it causes them to have to give their pet up. And we don't want that to happen. We want your pet to be able to stay with you as long as possible for the length of their life. And that means making sure that you're financially prepared. So let's talk about how to budget for your pet. Even if you already have a pet, this is a new year. Budget for, you know, all of the things that your pet may need in this upcoming year. So let's talk about it. Think about any questions that you have. You can put those in the chat and hopefully I can help you. But let's get started. What can I help you with?
All right. So what are the top expenses that, you know, a pet owner should look out for?
You know, overwhelmingly, the top expense is just going to be those unexpected medical expenses. So there's always times where your pet gets sick unexpectedly and you take your pet to the veterinarian. And sometimes, you know, the veterinary bill can be expensive and you didn't prepare for that. So you want to make sure that you have a fund set aside for emergencies. And this fund can vary, you know, in terms of how much you set aside is going to vary depending on the species of the dog that you have, the breed of the dog that you have. You know, you can consider, you know, your financial income for the month, and you can say, you know, I'm going to set aside 5 or 10% of my monthly income for my pet each month. And that can go for medical expenses, that can go for boarding, for grooming, for anything that your pet needs. You know, and even if you don't use it that month, you know, you can save it for a rainy day or a time where there's an unexpected expense. So maybe 5 to 10% of your monthly expenses could be something to set aside. If you can't do 5%, you know, do 3%, whatever you feel like you can spare to contribute to your pet's health care each month.
And then when people have talked about pet insurance, so how does that really work?
Yeah, so pet insurance, we hope that pet insurance becomes more popular in the future. It's really starting to take hold and people are learning more about pet insurance and how it can benefit them. The way pet insurance works is very much like it works in the human field. So you have to first do your research. There are going to be many companies that offer pet insurance policies. You will pay a monthly premium based on the services that you want your pet insurance to cover. So each pet insurance company and plan is different. Do you want the pet insurance to cover just wellness costs? Do you want it to cover emergencies? Do you want your pet insurance plan to cover any costs that you incur if your pet gets lost? There's lots of options that you have that your insurance plan can cover. So you just want to do the research and first figure out, what do you want your insurance to cover? Based on that, you will have to pay a premium associated with those services. Then, if and when your pet gets sick and you go to the veterinarian, one of two things will happen. Sometimes you will pay the full bill up front, and then you will submit a claim to your insurance company, and you will get reimbursed for those services that are part of your plan. And other times, you will just pay the deductible that you have agreed to based on your insurance plan, and then the insurance company will pay the remainder of the veterinary bill. So it's going to depend on the company and the plan that you choose and what services you offer. But, you know, pet insurance is a wonderful way to save costs and to help you be prepared for those routine medical visits and emergency visits.
And a lot of people are going to say, you know, my pet is very healthy right now. I don't need insurance right now. I'll just wait till later on till something happens. But then it might be too late.
Yes, it might be too late. And it might be too expensive. And so it's better just to have that money set aside and have a contingency plan, an emergency plan or pet insurance, because you don't want to get yourself caught in a situation where your pet needs immediate care and you don't have a way to provide financially for that immediate care. We want your pet to be able to get the care that he or she needs right away.
And a lot of times they don't cover, you know, if they already have an issue that later on we find out about.
Yes, certainly. So you also want to make sure that you look at the insurance plan, because sometimes if your pet does have pre-existing conditions, those may or may not be covered by the pet insurance company. So again, that's something to look for. Does the pet insurance company cover pre-existing conditions or not? And that can help you decide whether that plan is best for you and your pet.
And I've gone to like my local veterinarian clinic, and they usually have like a vet discount plan for sure. How does that differ from an insurance?
Yeah, so the veterinary discount plan, oftentimes that's just within a particular veterinary hospital. They may say, we will make and agree on a payment plan for you for your pet. That is just gonna be you working directly with your veterinarian and your veterinary clinic, where they may set up a payment plan for you. That could be, you know, paying a particular amount every month or, you know, every week, and they can work directly with you. And sometimes that's good because there's no interest involved and you're working directly with the company. And so certainly some veterinary clinics do that. And again, that's just compared to the insurance plan where you're working with a network and you're potentially having to pay up front and then get reimbursed, or at least pay a portion up front and wait for the claim to go through for the insurance company to pay again. Now, there are other similar discount plans available. So, you know, there's pet insurance. Then each individual animal clinic may set up a payment plan directly with you on terms that you agree with. And then there's another category in the middle where there are credit companies that can give you credit temporarily. So those might be companies like Scratch Pay or Care Credit. These are companies where you can apply for a line of credit that you can put your pet's medical care on this line of credit and then pay that company back. There usually is interest associated with that. So it could be a little bit more expensive depending on what's going on with your pet, but that's another option.
And then thinking ahead, what are some preventative care that we can focus on now that will help us out in the long run?
Yes, it's always preventive. Whatever you can do to prevent illnesses from happening is the best. So making sure that you take your pet to the veterinarian regularly, stay current on vaccinations, give heartworm prevention every month, give flea and tick prevention every month, keep your pet on a good diet, keep them safe. Keep them on a leash, keep them inside your yard to prevent, you know, accidents like being hit by a car. So it really is prevention, and that's going to save you the most money. Now, for some of those preventive measures and for some of that basic care, there are some veterinary clinics that are what we call low-cost veterinary clinics or affordable veterinary clinics. These veterinary clinics will often provide basic pet care at a reduced cost. So your exam fee, for example, to make an appointment to have your pet have an exam, may be at a reduced cost. Sometimes the vaccines are at a reduced cost. And oftentimes these clinics may only provide that routine basic care and you still have to go to another or separate veterinary hospital for advanced care, sometimes for blood work or for extensive surgery. Sometimes you may have to go to another veterinary hospital. But if you're interested in low cost or affordable veterinary clinics, you can Google it. There will be a list of clinics that comes up. Look at their website or call them and see what services they offer, because you may as well, you know, take advantage of those lower cost services. If that's what you need for your pet.
And we did have someone on Facebook ask, you know, you mentioned teeth cleaning as preventative care. How often should they go get their teeth cleaned?
Yes, preventive care is huge. And one of the things that you can do is, it depends on the breed that you have and how severe the dental disease is already. Typically for the average pet, we say once a year, just like we go get our teeth cleaned once a year, go get your pet's teeth cleaned professionally once a year. They're going to do all the scaling and the polishing and the fluoride treatment. They're going to get underneath the gum line and get all that bacteria out, because once your pet's teeth become infected and need to be extracted, the cost will go up significantly. I mean, we could be talking $1,000, $2,000 for tooth extractions. So a good way to prevent that extra cost is preventive maintenance.
And somebody else asked about harm prevention. You know, that can get somewhat expensive. Are there different options to consider for that?
Yes, there are certainly different options. So heartworm prevention is a medication that you give your pet most often every month. And what it does is, when you give your pet that medication, it prevents them from getting heartworm disease, which is transmitted through mosquito bites. So it's very common disease here in Texas and in all the southern states, but really it's been found in all 50 states. And it can be expensive. Once your pet contracts heartworm disease, the treatment is not only physically very hard on your pet, but it's very expensive as well. Now, heartworm prevention is given again every month, and there's lots of options. Sometimes the heartworm prevention is an oral tablet. Sometimes it's a topical liquid that you put on the skin between the shoulder blades. So not only are there different methods for administering this prevention, but there are also different types of medication that can do more than just prevent heartworms. So there are some medications that not only will prevent heartworms, but they can prevent intestinal parasites and fleas. And there are some products out there that are kind of all in one, where you can prevent heartworms, prevent fleas, prevent ticks, prevent intestinal parasites. So heartworm prevention can be as little as $2 a month, depending on the weight of your dog. But if you want to choose a product that does more for your pet, then sometimes that can be about $20 a month, depending on the size of your pet. So it can be expensive if you have maybe a 100-pound dog or bigger. You know, you may be looking closer to the $20 a month, but still, that is nothing. That $20 a month is nothing, and it's going to help prevent your pet from getting a condition that could cost thousands to treat, like heartworm disease.
And then, speaking of medications, you know, if we do have a pet that does take constant, like, medication just for the general health, do they offer generic options just like humans do? Is that a thing?
Yes, it sure is. So there are some generic options and, you know, some sort of brand name medications, and sometimes that cost will be different. And you can talk to your veterinarian. Some veterinary hospitals will carry only one type of product, and then some will carry the generic option and the brand name option. And so you can talk to your veterinarian about that. There are other options as well, such as online pet pharmacies. Online pet pharmacies often will sell the same veterinary medical products that your veterinarian does, and sometimes they will offer price matching. Now, there are some things to consider with online veterinary pharmacies. One of the things is that, let's say you get a medication from an online pharmacy, and for whatever reason, your pet has a reaction to it, or, you know, the product doesn't work. Sometimes the company that manufactures that product may not honor any guarantees if you purchase it through a third party, through an online pet pharmacy. Sometimes manufacturers only work directly with veterinarians. So something to consider if you're using an online pet pharmacy. But there can be benefits. Again, the price matching, sometimes the price is a little bit less expensive. but talk to your veterinarian because they may prefer that you purchase direct from them just so that you can guarantee that the medication has been handled appropriately, stored appropriately, and that you're still going to have that relationship with the manufacturer.
And I've heard that there are some medications you can call into like Walmart for a cheaper cost.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I picked up some meds for my dog just a few weeks ago from Walmart. So yes, a lot of grocery stores and stores like Walmart are starting to carry pet medications for convenience. You know, pets are part of our family. And if I'm going to Walmart for my own prescription because maybe I've got the flu and, you know, maybe my dog is coughing at the same time, we can get our medication together. So I think it's a wonderful thing that you're able to pick up some pet medications from your local pharmacy. And that certainly is more efficient and beneficial and shows the value that we are assigning to our pets these days.
And another way people have thought about saving money is grooming. Should we all take a stab at being a groomer, or should we just focus on the short dogs?
I don't know that everybody needs to be an at-home groomer. I've tried that before, you know, thinking that I could, because I could handle a scalpel blade and I could also handle a clipper blade, and the two are not exactly the same. My poor dog, you know, came out looking a little bit odd, but you know, it all grew back. So, you can certainly save money by doing an at-home groom if you feel confident. But if you don't know what you're doing, you could also, if nothing else, cause embarrassment to your pet because they're going to have a funny looking haircut. And you certainly don't want to accidentally, you know, cut them or injure them by trying to groom your pet at home. So I would say start off by taking your pet to a professional groomer. You know, if you want to learn how to groom, certainly there are things that you can do to start off to be safe at home. Like if you're using clippers, make sure that you always use a guard on your clippers so that you don't cut your pet too short. Make sure that the clippers are always fresh and that the blade is sharp so that you're not creating nicks and cuts in the skin. And you also want to make sure that you never use scissors, like just daily scissors on your pet. The scissors that you would use to cut paper or that you would use in your kitchen. You want to use appropriate tools as well, appropriate grooming tools. So there are certainly things that you can learn to do at home safely to save money. But if you're nervous about that and you're not certain about that, please use a professional groomer. It's going to be safer overall.
Somebody asked, you know, boarding a few nights can cost hundreds of dollars. If I can't travel with my pet, what are some like cost saving options?
Yeah, that's very true. I board my pet sometimes, and you're exactly right. Sometimes that cost can be $300 or $400 for a long weekend. And so if you're wanting to save money, there are a lot of organizations that do in-home pet sitting. So you can have someone come to your home and stay. You can also have someone just come to your home once or twice a day for checking in. So let's say you have a cat, you know, cats don't tend to need to be walked outside, but it's a good idea to have someone maybe come check on your cat once a day to make sure the food and water bowls are full. You can have someone come walk your dogs several times a day. Sometimes that may be less expensive than boarding your pet. And you can also consider another family member or friend that has pets or that doesn't have pets, but they don't mind babysitting for you. You can contact family and friends, and they're probably going to charge you much less than a boarding facility.
Are there other other things that we can do to cut cost?
Yes, absolutely. Lots of things you can do to cut costs. So again, you know, purchasing, we love to purchase things for our pets. And so things that you can do at home, like if you, instead of buying a $10 toy, there are oftentimes things that you can do at home to make toys. So you can look on Pinterest, or you can look on the internet and look up ways to make at-home toys. For example, water bottles. Lots of dogs love just playing with empty water bottles, just the crunch of it. You can put rocks inside of it and let it make noise, and they can throw it around. You can leave the top off and put small treats in there, and as they play with the water bottle, treats will come out. So there's lots of do-it-yourself toys that you can make. Again, we talked about the home grooming. If you're confident and you can be safe, you can save a little bit money on home grooming. And then, you know, pet sitting versus boarding, those are some ways that you can save money. And then finally, you know, when you're talking about in acquiring a pet for your family, you know, considering adopting a pet is another way to save money on all of those things that I spoke about before. When you adopt a pet, from a local animal shelter like the Houston SPCA, when you adopt a pet, everything that pet needs in the moment is taken care of. So your pet comes already spayed or neutered, which is a huge cost. That cost is already $400 or $500 that you're saving there. So they're spayed and neutered. They're current on all their vaccines, which often is another $100. They have heartworm and flea prevention already on board. So you've gotten a lot of that cost out of the way, and the adoption fee is less than $200. So you're getting a huge value for less than $200 for a pet that you adopt. Now, that adoption fee tends to be more expensive if you're purchasing a pet from a breeder. Sometimes or a purebred pet, those adoption fees tend to be higher. You could be looking at $1,000, $2,000, depending on the breed. So consider what you need for your family, for your life. Is it better to adopt a pet, or do you really need to have a purebred dog, depending on your lifestyle and what you want the pet to do? So, you know, there's another thing that you can do. Like, let's say that you are not quite prepared financially after having this long discussion about that. You may not be quite prepared financially to have a pet for yourself, but you love animals and you want them in your life. Something that you can do that will help you fill that need and to help the animals in the community is to consider being a foster parent. So what a good compromise, right? In terms of saving money, doing good for yourself, and doing good for another animal is becoming a foster parent. There are animals in our shelter all the time that need just temporary homes, just for a few weeks, sometimes just a few days. Sometimes it can be because they're too young to adopt out, so they just need time to grow and they're healthy. Sometimes they have minor illnesses or injuries that are easily taken care of with medication, and the Houston SPCA provides those medications, provides all the treatment for you, provides food for you, bedding, collars, leashes, so you would not have to spend anything on your pet unless your foster pet, unless you wanted to, and we would provide all that for you. So it's a great way to fill that place in your heart that says you want a pet as part of your family, but maybe if you're not really ready for the financial responsibility, we can help you with that. We can give you a pet. And we can also provide everything that pet needs to be comfortable while in your care. So we thank you for joining us again. You know, talking about pet budgeting and preparing for your pet is just really another thing that you can do this year to make sure that you and your pets stay healthy and happy throughout the year and for life. So please continue to join us every Friday, and hopefully we can continue to give you tips and tricks for your pets. And please come on down and visit Galant. Look how handsome he is. It just doesn't get cuter than that or more handsome than that. He is a very sweet dog, and he's as soft as he looks. He is very, very soft, so he's perfect for cuddling. So again, thank you. Come on down and visit us, and we will see you next week here at the Houston SPCA. I'm your host, Dr. Westbrook.